Today we're going to be talking about evaluation of a music lesson. So this topic is a bit tricky, but we're going to look at things that you can do as a student, things that you can look for to help you through a music lesson or a series of lessons. This might also be applicable to a teacher who's just wanting to make sure that all of these particular subcategories of this topic are covered. This topic does take me back to being younger and looking through tablature, looking through Guitar World, and trying to understand and teach myself how to play tablature. Then I wanted to get into notation and how to translate that onto the actual guitar. And I had to look for a teacher who would teach me that specific ability. So hopefully this helps you today, and let's just dive right on into it. So the first thing we're going to talk about is preparation. So was the lesson prepared? Teachers and students should both be on the same page as to the goals and intent of what's trying to be accomplished. This is a very important topic because there have been times where students show up, they're not prepared for a lesson, and perhaps the teacher wasn't prepared. Maybe the teacher did not know what you were wanting to work on or working on. It's important to connect with your teacher and make sure that you both are on the same page as to what those goals and outcomes are so that you may be guided through to that final goal. And you as the student, the second point there, were you truly prepared for the lesson? Did you as the student follow up and build on the previous lesson if any were given? Of course, that doesn't apply if it's a first lesson. Let's take a look at the second point, which would be content. We're going to talk about here, what particular style period are you studying? Is it something as simple as, you know, rock and roll? Or is it something like Bach? Whatever it might be, from the Beatles to Bach, from Hendrix in that case to Bach, you want to understand a specific style, a specific period. I would think also as far as content, historical background of the era, what did you or do you already know about the specific era of music being studied, Renaissance, Baroque, Romantic, 20th century, composers, dates. Your breadth and depth of knowledge. Basically, that's something that every series of lesson or a lesson should convey is breadth and depth of knowledge. How much did you gain in a particular subject or a particular piece? So moving on to our next point that I would like to make for evaluation of a music lesson, we would look at pacing. Was the lesson paced appropriately? Was it too fast or too slow? These are some things that you can certainly talk about with your instructor if they're moving too fast. Understand, go into the next lesson and say, hey, could we slow this down and look at something? Don't be afraid to ask. Oftentimes, instructors can move too fast and not know that you don't understand it if you don't say something. So make sure that that communication is key. Communication falls in line with pacing quite well. And in general, you should expect, if this is a beginning lesson, expect beginning lessons to be generally slower. The increase with intensity and pacing will come as you get more advanced. Sequencing. So were the lessons building on previous material? Or are you starting fresh? Is this applicable? The depth of understanding will increase or is it remaining static, or are you not learning something from it? Those are some kind of things to keep in mind as you look through a series of lessons as well. Hopefully you're building on knowledge from lesson to lesson and learning something new. A new concept. Goals, really from most basic to advanced, we need to understand tone and technique. That's going to be one of the first things that you're looking at. In other words, you know, are you playing dolce? Are you playing ponticello towards the bridge of the guitar, towards the neck of the guitar? Are you playing on the edge of the nail or the side? All those things are tone variations. Looking at your technique as you have already, from hand positioning to posture to vibrato and those sorts of things. All of that's important in some of the first lessons that you learn. Moving on from that, you would generally get into obviously note reading in a particular piece. Basically, are you playing the rhythms and the notes properly? Are you in the proper key? Those sort of things. Finally, if you're more advanced and into a more advanced lesson, you're looking at dynamics and stage presence. And those are some things that will certainly guide you in terms of evaluating if that particular lesson is where your goals lie for both teacher and student. The final things we want to talk about are feedback. Really, a great lesson is going to include specific feedback. There's going to be specific things that you're told to make an improvement. Modeling. Is there a sense of what is being suggested? Perhaps with a playing experience through, because playing is an experience, and through the teacher and the modeling of the piece being studied. In other words, to simplify this, was the teacher able to specifically model and convey what's needed to get an end result from the student? So that's something to think about there. Do you know what's expected of you? And if not, how can you find out? What are some ways in which you can do that? I think it comes down to building that relationship and having that motivation, which is our last point. Motivation is the key to learning, okay? If the lesson is engaging, the motivation is certainly a part of that, and it's going to help you to accomplish a lesson goal. Is there a sense of personality and chemistry that may produce a positive outcome for the student? So basically, if we take all of those things and look at them, we can start to evaluate what it is within a lesson that we've learned or haven't learned and can work. And I think over a series of lessons, really start to develop and seek out and accomplish goals within our lessons. It's up to both student and teacher to figure those things out and evaluate some of these things as far as the learning that has happened. Take these into consideration as you look for that perfect lesson or series of lessons. So I hope this has been a help for you, and thank you for watching.
Now, I would like to talk about how to stop the sound. And for example, when you play cello or violin, if you want a sound, you really have to make an action to create the sound because you have the arch. But with the guitar, you can just play and just forget about it, and it will sound until you stop the sound. So that's why it's really important to have the technique to stop sounds on the guitar. We have to practice how to stop sounds with the thumb, but also with the other fingers. Let's start with the thumb. I make three kinds of movements to stop sounds. The first one is to stroke the string and then go back immediately to the string. Like so, it's you stroke and then you go back immediately. So with this, we can really just practice like that, like try to play as short as possible. Like. Another one is you play the string and then you play the other string and then go back to the first string. So like, and then I came back to the first. So again, sixth string, and then I play the fifth and stop the sixth. These sounds is using this part of the finger. Imagine the sixth string is ringing and I want to stop it at the same time when I play the fifth string. So I will move towards the fifth string and with this part of the finger I will stop the sixth. So I play this. Note that with this you will need to move a little bit this part of your hand, no? The wrist. You have to go a bit closer to the strings. But, I mean, it's just to have flexibility on the hand. It's not like you stay here. No, you just move a little bit. Exercise will be just to play the open strings, and then when you play the fifth, you stop the sixth. And And then when you play the four, you stop the fifth. One more time. Now, let's talk about how to stop sounds, but with these fingers, with the ring finger, M finger, index, all these, not in the thumb. So, it's the same idea. So let's try to start just with this exercise. Just really short movement. You can alternate fingers. But this is in one string. So imagine you want to play melody. Okay. If I don't stop the sound, the E will continue sound with sounding. Yeah. So if I want to avoid this, I will have to stop the first string. I can use one of the fingers here to stop this sound. So what I do is I move two fingers. Imagine this is the first string and this is the second. So I move the two fingers at the same time and I stroke the second string with the M finger, and with the ring finger I stop the sound of the first. So it's like this. They two come together, but one stays on the string and the other moves. So, let's try again. You hear? So. Yeah. It's not.
Hi everyone, I'm back with my final video here to give you some left-hand tips, hopefully to make your life a little easier. In the past few weeks, I've talked a lot about how to align your hand, keeping your wrist straight, keeping your palm kind of concave, fingers curled, thumb pad relaxed, all that good stuff. Also, how to sort of generate force with these big knuckles, where to aim, how hard to press. A lot of stuff. Hopefully these exercises have made sense to you and your teachers have been able to walk you through them. I know I'm moving quite fast, so hope they've all been really good for you. Today I'm going to take the same ideas and apply them to two slightly more advanced topics, namely bars and slurs. So a couple little bar tips first of all. I like to tell my students to think of sort of like a capo when you're making a bar with your index finger. Everyone knows what a capo is, and it's kind of what it looks like if you do this sort of like a little capo here. So what you want to do is you want to keep your finger as parallel to the fret as you can, meaning the big knuckle has to be sort of in a straight line with the rest of your finger. A lot of times I see people try to make a bar and the big knuckle is sort of tucked under like this, and that's going to cause you to get some muted notes up here. So that's the first thing you want to do. Next thing, I find a lot of people also get the thumb tense and do a big squeezing motion when working on a bar. For me, I find if we can sort of use not only the strength from this knuckle, as I've been talking about for a few weeks, but also pulling back with your arm a little bit into the fretboard. What I mean by that is if you take your thumb off the neck and sort of just pull back, you see, obviously, the guitar is going to come out this way, but I'm pulling force into the neck. If I just rest my arm here, totally dead weight, don't need to really do anything, just as if I'm going to play, and pull back with my arm, I can actually make a bar without my thumb on the neck. Now this is again an exaggeration. You're not going to play like this. Your thumb is going to be back there for support, but this is just a little reminder that you don't need to squeeze. And with a little bit of strength from here, slightly pulling back and resting your arm here, you should be able to get some cleaner and more relaxed bar chords. Lastly, you can also curve on the left side of your finger. That helps some people too, using the bonier side rather than the fleshy front. Okay, a few bar tips for you. Hope that helped. Moving on to slurs. Let's go to fifth position and just do some hammer-ons with fingers next to each other. I'll start with one and two on each string. So, fifth fret, sixth fret, fifth fret, sixth fret. Sorry, I have a tendency of vibrating every note. Don't do that. So I'm doing it quite slow, and you'll see I'm actually sort of doing what we were doing with the target practice in the very first lesson, kind of like this. You may have been told to practice your slurs by keeping your lower finger down, which is a good way to practice it as well, but I'm really trying to, again, build up independence in your fingers and perfect timing as to when they land on the fretboard. So you can take this drill, do it with other fingers as well, two and three, or three and four. Get creative, different combinations. But once again, what you're trying to remember when you're doing it is that moving of the left hand thumb, keeping the fingers curled, moving from here. All the stuff I've been talking about, we're just now doing it with hammer-ons, okay? Finally, pull-offs. Similar idea here, hand curved, thumb relaxed, six, five. The key here is with your lower finger, make sure you're not pressing too hard. I often see players have struggling to pull down. If you make sure this finger is pressing with just that minimal amount of pressure that we worked on finding with the buzzing exercise, it should be easier. Next, you'll also get a better slur if you pull directly down. It's more like a pull down as opposed to a pull off. You see right here, it's almost like I'm doing a rest stroke with the finger pulling off. I'm not pulling out. That doesn't really work. Gonna be much better if I keep a light touch, proper hand alignment, and pull down on the string. Really crisp, clear sound. Again, you can do them all over the fretboard. Maybe if you're working on slurs down here in first position mostly, take the drill down there. Okay, that's it for me for all my left hand tips. I know it's a lot to remember, but just whatever you're playing, whether it's a chord, a melody, a scale, just try to keep all these alignment things and where you generate motion from in mind. Hopefully it can make you play cleaner, more beautifully, easier, less frustrating, all that good stuff. Have fun. Happy practicing. Thank you.
Hello again. Back for another chord playing session. So, in the first three sessions that I saw you for, we went through some of the basics of left hand technique when it came to playing chords, how to get your left hand cleaner, how to get it more fluid, which just makes you a better guitar player, makes you sound better, makes it easier to play. We also then were looking specifically with all of that stuff at chords within the key of C major. We've been focusing on these six specific chords: C, D minor, E minor, F, G major, and A minor, or what we call the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 chord in the key of C. In the third session, I went through about half a dozen really basic chord progressions relating to the key of C major. I shouldn't say basic, I should say fundamental, meaning you see them in play in music all the time. If you can play those chord progressions like the back of your hand, you find that you're learning the foundation of all pop music. So what starts to happen after a while is you're learning lots of new songs. You're not really learning lots of new songs. You're learning chord progressions that you've practiced, you've played time and again, and they just happen to be the basis for the newest song you want to practice or you want to learn. So what I want to do is I want to go on a little bit from the end of the third session. In the end of the third session, I had you practicing a 1-6-5-1 progression in the key of C. So to recap, that was a C major chord, an A minor chord, which is the sixth chord, the G major chord, and then back to the C major chord. That's what we call a 1-6-5 progression. We talked about, and you know, that chord progressions in popular music are typically four bars or four measures that just repeat themselves with four different chords in them. So what we're going to do is, to get a bit creative, we're going to take that same principle of progressions that we covered in session 3. But now I want you to get a little bit of creative kind of in the middle. So what does that mean? I want you to think in terms of a four bar progression or a four measure progression. So you're going to start in bar one, measure one, with a C chord. The fourth measure is going to be a G chord. But in measures 2 and 3, you can put in there any chord from the key of C major that we've been dealing with. So what does that mean? I might play in my first bar a C major chord, and then go to the 6th chord, A minor, then go that G chord. So basically, I've got my starting bar, C, my fourth bar, my ending bar in this progression is a G. In bar 2 and 3, I can think of any one of those chords in the key of C. Now, if you're anything like me and you're not great at memory, literally write them down on a piece of paper and just kind of literally look at them as you're playing. But in bar 2 and bar 3, you decide, mix and match, pick from those chords that are in the key and pop them into those bars. So let's try that again. This time now I'm going to do a 1-6-2-5. So what I'm going to do, a 1 chord, C major, my 6th chord would be A minor, my 2 chord, is that what I said I was going to play, would be D minor, and then G. So again, C at the beginning, G in bar 4, and in bar 2 and 3, I'm just putting any one of those chords. So C, I did those middle two a different way around, but you get the picture. So what you're doing here is you're kind of sticking within the parameters of that C major harmonies. So you're sticking within the parameters of C, D minor, E minor, F major, G major, A minor. You're kind of sticking in within the kind of the bookend parameters of this chord progression that I'm saying. Start with a C chord, end with a G chord, but you've got two bars there to just put in whatever you want. So what do you start to notice? That basically is how songs are written, okay? So there's probably a bit more to that, especially if you're the Beatles, but it is literally following these kind of same chord progressions all the time. So two things, by practicing this way, what you are doing is I notice, and this is, you know, a stretch for me, but I'm having to really think when I play. So especially if I'm doing it on the fly, you can kind of start out by literally kind of thinking about what you want to play before you play it. So you can go, okay, I know I'm playing a C and I know I'm playing a G. In between, I'm going to play a D minor and an E minor. Or as you start to get a bit better at this and you know these chords even better cognitively, which chord goes again, or kind of what chords I've got to pull on. I keep doing this. What I'm literally envisioning is those 6 chords up in the air that I kind of grab and put in those bars. So what it does, though, it means that I'm thinking quite a bit when I'm practicing, which is difficult for me. I like to just play and not think. But again, I'm kind of then putting together all of these things that we've talked about in these few sessions. I'm thinking a little bit about theory as I'm playing. I'm thinking a little bit about technique as I'm playing. I'm, of course, thinking about trying to play these progressions nice and solid, nice and steady, like we talked about in session 2. I'm also then being a little bit creative with my practice. So what I'm going to do is this. I'm just going to kind of, to finish up here, I'm just going to give you an example here. I'm going to play these 4-bar progressions. I'm just going to kind of see what comes up. But I'm sticking within that kind of parameter, a 1 chord at the beginning, the 5 chord, the G chord at the end, and I'm going to loop that a few times and see what I end up putting in bar 2 and 3. So here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Could go on for days, but I won't. I'll leave it there. But you get the concept. So there, in these past 4 sessions, I've talked about basic chords and basic good left-hand chord playing principles, which you can apply to anything. But then what I did was kind of kept the focus with these six sets of chords. Why these six? Because again, that's underlying that is basic music theory. And then a little bit of creative practice as well thrown in. There, we're covering all of the basics. So good luck with your chord practice. Hope this was helpful. See you soon.